Good morning. Merry Christmas. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church, all of you. We're very grateful you're here to enjoy worshiping the Lord together as we start to celebrate the end of 2016 and enjoy the advent of Jesus officially today and then prepare ourselves for a new year. There's several things I want to talk to you about as we begin to look forward to 2017. And the first is there's a lot of ministry activity happening this week that we want you to be in prayer about. Our youth are going on Wednesday to Hilton Head for a service trip there to work with another PCA church. One of the beautiful things that happened through the devastation of Hurricane Matthew was when the trees fell down in Hilton Head, the need started to reveal themselves. And so the church has been very active, and they've asked our youth to come and help them with ministry they're doing. So that's beginning this Wednesday. Of course, our campus outreach and our medical campus outreach have their conferences coming up. Please be in prayer for those as well. And then in January, we start our Gospel Priorities series. We'll have a series of guest preachers. January 1st, Pastor Robertson will preach to lead that series off. We'll have one service next Sunday at 10 a.m. again on New Year's Day. And then the following Sundays in January, we have guest preachers. And we do that to ask the Lord to reveal His gospel priorities and refresh our minds with what He's called us to do in 2017. But it also serves as an opportunity for Pastor Robertson to have time to have a sort of in-town sabbatical where he prepares messages and gets ahead on projects, writing, and preaching opportunities that he has. So January's a big month in the life of our church as well. I would remind you, too, that year-end giving this week, you can give here. The church offices will be open through Friday. And, of course, if things are postmarked by December 31st in the mail, that will count towards year-end giving as well. We want to encourage you and ask you to talk to the Lord this week, talk to your families, and ask, how can we continue to give as well as we've given all year long? It's been really remarkable what the Lord has done through the generosity of this church. And new ministry objectives and new opportunities have arrived and will present themselves in 2017 because of the faithful giving of this congregation. We're sort of overwhelmed by how God continues to bless and grow our church. I think that's all I want to talk to you about, so let's keep those things in mind. But right now, let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Joy, 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 my heart. Joy, joy, joy. My heart is filled with joy.
With joy in response to God's love on this Christmas morning, let's answer his call to worship. Let sinners rejoice for their Savior is born. Let the just rejoice.
For their justifier is born.
Let the sick and infirm rejoice.
For their great physician is born.
Let the captives rejoice.
For their redeemer is born.
Let slaves rejoice.
For their master is born.
Let free men rejoice. Let all Christians rejoice.
Jesus Christ is born.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us worship our Savior.
Lift your hands to this great God as we pray. Our gracious Father, our hearts are filled with joy today. We're moved by your love, the love so great that you would send your Son to be the Redeemer of all peoples, people from every tribe and tongue and language and nation. Our Lord God, you loved us so much that you sacrificed your very own Son for us. And this day, we are so grateful. Our hearts are filled with joy. And we remember those this morning whose hearts are not so joyful. They're suffering. They're in the hospital. They've received a bad diagnosis. Father, for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones this very day, we pray that the mercy and sweetness of King Jesus, the hope of the resurrection, the promise that you are coming again for that second and greater advent, where you will make all things new and fix all that is broken. May that be their hope and their joy today. For our friends who are here who have not yet met Jesus personally, on this Christmas day, where we could think of nowhere else we'd rather be than in the worship of our great God, would this be the day that they understand your love and bow the knee to King Jesus? For all of us, we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come down and capture our hearts, our affections, our minds, our wills. Cause us to see you and to love you with all of our hearts. And we pray it in Jesus' name. And God's people said together, amen.
The Advent wreath has served to remind us this Christmas season of the major blessings we have received as a result of the gift of God's Son. During the past four Sundays, we have paused to light the four outside candles that stand for
hope, peace, love, and joy.
Center candle stands for God's greatest gift of all, the Lord Jesus Christ, from whom comes the hope, love, joy, and peace that we celebrate. Focusing on the coming of Jesus, the angel announced to Joseph, "You shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sin." The angel Gabriel announced to the Virgin Mary, "Behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end."
Remember how the angel spoke to the shepherds, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Notice how the shepherds responded. "Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." Let us, like the shepherds, go to Bethlehem and worship the one who has been born a Savior, Christ the Lord.
The Bible says that if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But God in his mercy sent the Lord Jesus to be the propitiation of our sins. It's a word that means that the wrath of Jesus, the wrath of God was satisfied in the life and death of Jesus. And because of that, we don't have to be afraid of God. We who know the Lord Jesus and have been forgiven of our sins can come to the throne of grace every Lord's Day and hear God the Father pronounce over us again that our sins are forgiven. So I'd invite you, if you're able, let's kneel before the Lord now and confess our sins. Would you join me now in this corporate confession of sin? Gracious Father, in your tender mercy, you have visited us from on high to deliver us from sin and darkness. Even though the saving grace of God has appeared to us, we have failed to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions. We have failed to live self-controlled, upright and godly lives in this present age. We have been materialistic, self-centered, rebellious, prideful, and careless. We have not loved you with all our hearts, souls, minds, and strength. Christ our Savior, you gave yourself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for yourself a people that are your very own, eager to do what is good. Forgive us and make us that kind of beautiful church. Holy Spirit, sanctify us that we might serve God in holiness and righteousness all our days. Amen. Here's the good news of the gospel, friends. From 1 Timothy chapter 1, here's a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Let's respond. Would you stand as we sing this carol in response?
Pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for greeting us this day with the good news of the gospel, that a Savior has been born to us, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. We come into your presence, the presence, your presence in this your throne room from which you guide and control the universe, shaping all things to the praise of your glorious grace, and we pour out on you all of our concerns and burdens, even on this day. We pray today, Father, for those whose hearts are breaking with various struggles. Continue to pray for Renee Campbell, for Mildred Coleman's healing. We praise you for bringing David Hanks through a very serious and sensitive surgery, even this week, and ask for complete healing for him. We pray for Rod Veazey's family grieving his loss in the wee hours of this morning. We thank you, Lord, for a man who finished well and a man who would come and testify to us even the slightest and most momentary of healings in his last years of battle with illness and disease. We thank you for a man who came to worship when he had many excuses for not coming. We thank you for his devoted twin brother who came last night to worship and then went back to help usher his brother into heaven. We pray your comfort on this family this day and for traveling mercies as they come from around the country. We pray for Amy Paulk, who lost her father last night too, and ask that you would comfort them as they seek to make arrangements in Colombia and comfort and unite their family, extended family. Thank you, Lord, that in this season of heartache and difficulty, you give us a peace that passes all comprehension, and pray for that peace to be with others in our congregation and those that we have loved formerly in this congregation as well, like Kama Fowler nearing death and her husband Paul, who served here with such distinction, for Jen Soto, who suffers from serious physical pain this season too. Oh Lord, we pray for mercy and strength and compassion. We thank you, Lord, for reminding us in this very special of all seasons, we thank you for reminding us that God is with us, that he put on flesh in order that he might be our sympathetic high priest and remains empathetic to us even at the right hand of the Father, because he can still feel our pain and intercede for us with 5 bleeding wounds. We ask, O Lord, that we this day would properly praise and thank you for your so great salvation, even as we continue to pray as you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. Please pass the fellowship pad down your pew.
Sisters, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's pass that peace now.
Please be seated. I'll ask you again to turn to the same passage we looked at last night, Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. And again, I'm going to read from Exodus chapter 4 while you're turning there. And that reaction of the Hebrew leaders to the news from Moses and Aaron that God was going to release them from their captivity in Egypt. Last night we focused on the first part of that reaction, and that in reaction to God's revelation, by word and by sign, they believed. And by word and by sign, we must believe that God offers us salvation, has secured our salvation in Jesus Christ. But there's a second part to this reaction that we must not miss, especially on this Christmas morning. So with your attention focused on Matthew 2, I want you to listen as I read from Exodus chapter 4. Moses and Aaron brought together all the elders of the Israelites, and Aaron told them everything the Lord had said to Moses. He also performed signs before the people, and they believed. And when they heard that the Lord was concerned about them and had seen their misery, they bowed down and worshiped. Matthew chapter 2. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had called together all the peoples, chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way. And the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Let's pray together. We thank you, Lord, for this your word, inspired and inerrant, and finds us by the inspiration of the Spirit and by the converting power of the Spirit, causes us to believe, but not just believe. And we truly believe the good news of the gospel of a merciful God who has saved us from our sins in Jesus Christ. We must bow down. Cause us, Lord. After the hustle and bustle of this season, in the midst of this day when our hearts feel like they're going to beat out of our chest, we pray, Lord, that you would give us time to bow and say thank you in holy awe of such a great salvation. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. When we were in college, Jackie and her sister and I took a trip to England. We had been in Holland, and we went over to England, and we could have made a remake of Mark Twain's Innocents Abroad. We had no idea what it meant to travel internationally. And one of the early lessons that we had to learn, or I had to learn the hard way, was the value of money in different countries. We had just sort of gotten used to the currency value in Holland, and then we had to go across the channel and learn a little bit of a different culture, and we converted our money there, our Dutch money, into British pounds. And being the innocent that I was, and redneck as I was from Mississippi, I didn't know the value of the money I had in my pocket. We were coming back from dinner late one night, and out of the shadows, this inebriated homeless man approached me and asked for some change for a meal. I didn't think he was going to purchase another meal, but the way I decided I would handle it was, I said, "I'll just give you the change that's in my pocket." And he was grateful for whatever he was going to get, although he thought that it wasn't going to be very much. And so I emptied my pocket of all the change I had. I dropped it in his hands. And when that man glanced over the money that I put in his hand, he dropped to his knees and held his hands up to heaven and praised me and praised God for this abundance of blessing that had just been put in his hands. Now, I thought it was a bit of an overreaction. It's just pocket change, I thought. And the man's not quite with it, and it's a nice reaction, but not necessary, until I got back and did an accounting of the money that I had left, which was not a whole lot, because I had poured a bunch of pounds in his hand. There are certain experiences that cause us spontaneously to bow, that we can't help it. When we are confronted with these kinds of experiences, our body knows naturally what to do. It must bend, it must break, it must fall. And that man was only reacting naturally to a gift larger than he had ever possibly received in his life, more money than he possibly had ever held in his own hands, and he knew he could never repay it, and it threw him, it forced him, plunged him to his knees. And it is the reaction that we find in these two settings that we've read from this morning. The Hebrew elders, when they hear news that they thought too good to be true, news that they had given up hope for, news that God was going to deliver them from 430 years of slavery, and a similar reaction by Magi when they had been led on a dangerous journey into the backyard of a maniacal ruler, to bow before a humble child whose God had revealed to them that he was the king not only of the Jews, but the savior of the nations. When they were confronted with that grace, they dropped to their knees and gave gifts worthy not just of a king, but of God. Posture is important. Posture is important in prayer. As we have, in our course of history together as pastor and people, we have said often that we want to learn to respond to God in all the ways that the psalmist does. And one of those ways has been bowing in prayer, lifting our hands, bowing in prayer, standing in prayer, but bowing especially, kneeling especially. We even install furniture to enable us to do that. We, by practicing a biblical posture of prayer, can actually teach our hearts how to worship. How to live in a constant state of reality. Not just to wait for those rarefied moments when something great overwhelms us, or when we receive a gift that we cannot repay and then can only then spontaneously bend our bodies in obeisance and humility. We can train ourselves to live in the reality of the need constantly to worship. Many of you have been reading James K.A. Smith's new book, You Are What You Love. And Smith, throughout his career as a philosopher, has been fascinated with this idea of that your physical human practices can produce virtuous and loving dispositions. And so he's most fascinated, as a Christian scholar, he's most fascinated with how that works in worship. And so he talks about virtue-shaping liturgies. Now, we say it around here as things that cut deep grooves in your mind. So we believe that liturgical worship is something that is important for us to discipline ourselves, to train ourselves, to live properly in a proper posture of repentance and humility and gratitude in the rest of our lives too. We believe by regularly repeating gospel drama, like God calls us to worship, we respond to Him. We lift our hands to Him in worship, in reception of the good gifts He brings. He calls us to confession of our sins. We bow down in humility. He assures us of pardoning grace. We stand up and receive it. We cast all our cares upon Him. We sit down to be taught by Him. We hold our hands out to be blessed by Him. And by doing that over and over and over again, we trust that the Spirit takes that physical activity and engraves it into our minds and hearts so that we begin to live in that reality, that every good and perfect gift comes from Him alone, and my only purpose in life is to respond in doxological gratitude to Him. So can you train yourself to live more realistically in a posture of humility and repentance by practicing a posture of humility and prayer? This is what James Smith says about kneeling, in particular, kneeling in confession and voicing the things we have done and the things we have left undone tangibly and viscerally impresses upon us the brokenness of our world and humbles our own pretensions. Thomas Howard, Elizabeth Elliot, the famous Elizabeth Elliot's brother, Thomas Howard, reflected on the first time he walked into an evangelical church which was bowing, kneeling in prayer. And he reflected on that and he said this: we sit for a thousand things, to eat, to chat, to work, to write notes, to rest. It may be that our bodies cry out for an attitude that will pluck us by the sleeve, as it were, and assist our inner beings in the extremely difficult task of prayer. These magi spontaneously responded to the greatness of the God they were in front of by bowing down. These Hebrew leaders spontaneously responded to this good news that God was concerned for them and bowed down. And we must not only respond spontaneously when we remember afresh that God is good to us, we must bend our bodies and kneel and bow regularly to remind ourselves, to teach ourselves, it is true all the time, not just occasionally. That's what made this impression on these Hebrew leaders, on these magi, that God is good. He is concerned for us. He saw our misery. These magi realized that the prophecy was that this one who was going to be born a king was becoming a king in order to shepherd us. Do you know that today? Do you know that one who created the stars of the universe and created that miracle of the star that led the magi to this humble house, that God loves you? That God doesn't just love you generically. That God is not just merciful to humanity, but that God is concerned about you. That God who put on flesh in order to say to you through scarred hands and feet and a bruised brow, I am concerned about you. I see your misery, and I am entering into your misery with you that I might someday set you totally free from it. That word, translated concerned, is a fascinating word in Hebrew. It means generically, it's just attention. It's to pay attention. But it's translated differently because God pays different kinds of attention to different kinds of people. So in Hebrews chapter 4, in Exodus chapter 4, the Hebrew leaders learned that he was concerned for them. But later, that same word is translated in another context as warfare. It's not God's concern, it's his visiting warfare on people who have rebelled against him. One word with radically different meanings. One meaning to watch over with concern and mercy and pity like a shepherd over his sheep. Another of hostility and anger and warfare. What makes the difference? How are you going to turn God's attention towards you in a way that's pleasant? How are you going to transform his wrath against you for your sin, that wrath that John alluded to earlier in our service, that wrath that has to be propitiated, has to be satisfied? How are you going to turn that into pity? You can't do it. The Hebrew leaders couldn't do it. God had to prepare Moses, even a very reluctant servant, had to prepare him as a mediator, brought him across the desert, brought him bravely into Egypt, and announced, God has chosen to have pity on you, though you don't deserve it. Those magi were looking desperately for an answer, but they couldn't have found it. I don't know, they couldn't have found it on their own. They couldn't have found the explanation for the order of the universe. But God spoke to them. God found them. God drew them to himself. Those shepherds were not looking for an angelic choir when they were in that pasture. God found them. And God announced, even as he announces to you, I offer compassion. I offer concern. I offer pity. I offer salvation in a shepherd. And all you can do is accept it. And when you really understand it, when you accept it, when you know that though you did not deserve it, though you did not seek him first, and he revealed that salvation to you, when that gets hold of you, it should overwhelm you and drop you to your knees in gratitude. Physically, yes, in worship, but constantly in a posture of humility and repentance. There are some truths that are just too powerful to describe. They can only be taught by an object lesson. So I want to show you a brief video. I want you to, this is an unusual worship service on a very special day, so why not end the sermon in an unusual way? I want to sear in your mind an image of being overwhelmed with gratitude and a physical response to it. And then we're going to imitate it in a brief moment of worship following. And be ready for the rest of our day of celebration and worship. Let me set up the story before you see it. My friend Matt Chandler, friend of Mike Heron and others in this congregation too, pastors a church called The Village in Fort Worth. And The Village Church has a very significant outreach to the thousands of refugees who land in the Dallas-Fort Worth airport on a regular occasion. In 2012, they welcomed into their fellowship a Sudanese refugee, a woman who had two young children in tow and was expecting her third. Her husband wasn't with her. They'd gotten separated. He was detained in a refugee camp where he would be detained for the next 4 years. You can imagine the heartache and the heartbreak, day after day, wondering if they would ever see one another again. Two women in the Village Church pledged themselves to her, attached themselves to her, and walked every day of those 4 years with her, even through labor and delivery and the caring for that newborn baby. Well, this year, their husband, Dion, was restored. Their father, her husband, was restored to them. He arrived in the Dallas-Fort Worth airport, a large delegation from the Village Church, those two women on either side of his wife, his now three little children, one whom he had never met before, greet him. And I want you to enter in to the emotion of that moment. Jesus himself, let us go to our knees one more time. Silent reflection, prepare ourselves for the rest of this day. Let us rise and sing. forth your hands for his blessing. Christ has come. Let the earth be glad. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and his gift, the Lord Jesus Christ. Go in peace. Amen.